Hey everyone, it's Jim from Vowels and More, an online vintage tube store. And today in Tube Lab number 131, we're going to talk a little bit about how to match your power amp output to your speaker input. But first, caution everyone, electronics and tube amplifiers can have very high voltages present, which can be lethal. Exercise extreme caution when working around them. Always consult a professional technician when in doubt. Load matching your power amp to your speakers is critical to not only avoid overloading your power amp, but also for creating the best conditions electrically for quality sound. Obviously, if you've loaded down your output stage, solid state or tube, the amp is not going to perform at its best, and you're going to lose power and possibly overheat your amp and do some damage, serious damage. So let's take a look at some sketches I've made and see if we can figure out what the heck we're talking about. So there's a bunch of measurements and specifications that are important. So we're going to start actually way over here at the end of the music, the speakers. This is a little sketch of my open baffles. Now, efficiency is really important for power matching. Some amplifiers just can't drive an inefficient speaker. That's just the way it is. You can't force that, or you're going to damage your amplifier and you're not going to have great sound. So it's important that you look at the efficiency of your speakers. We've talked about this before, so you can go back to your previous tube lab. But in general terms, in my opinion, after years and years and many, many speaker systems, I much prefer the sound of a more efficient speaker. Yes, if you've got a less efficient speaker, maybe with a huge amount of power, it'll sound good. But why in the heck would you want to do that? Power costs money, it makes for complications, it doesn't make any sense to me. So I would go with more efficient speakers every time. If I had a choice between two speakers and they were both well reviewed and one was more efficient, it doesn't take a genius to figure out what I would choose. Anyways, so efficiency is important. Because the less efficient your speakers, the more power you're going to need. Okay, everybody got that. So let's start at the top of the system. So this is my everyday system. Now it rotates because we have quite a few prototype and quite a few kit amps that we sell. And on any given day it can rotate. But typically I'll have something like the E80CC preamp in here. Often I have the universal in, simply because I do a lot of testing of 6SN7, 6GU7 tubes, etc. So it's always a treat when I can get the E80 in. So today, because it's my system, I put the E80 in. I love the clarity of the E80CC tube. In fact, interestingly enough, the 6GU7 we were talking about just recently in Tube Lab, it's a unique sounding tube, but it's close to the kind of clarity the E80CC has, and that is a tube, let me tell you. And I just wish the bloody things were more affordable. Okay, back on topic. So Charles is away, by the way, so he's not here to nudge me. Dad, get back on topic. So here we're often running the GU50 power amp. This is our mono block, and we've got two taps on the output stage. We've got a 4-ohm tap and an 8-ohm tap. Okay, now some of you might be lucky and you'll have a 4, 6, and 8. Some of you might be unlucky and you've only got an 8-ohm tap. But most of you probably have a 4 and 8-ohm tap. Okay, now speakers will have what's called a nominal impedance. And these days, they're almost always going to be a nominal 4-ohm, 6-ohm, or 8-ohm impedance. Now, what the heck is impedance? Impedance is electrical resistance. And in speakers, it's fairly complex because the impedance rises with the frequency of the signal. And of course, an audio signal is a composite, right, of many frequencies. And you also have a coil of wire around here in behind, you know, that big magnet thing. Well, inside of that, we've got a coil of wire that's going in and out, right? Out on the positive phase, back in, the cone moves back in on the negative phase. That's how sound is created. That coil of wire has inductance. So inductance and resistance make for a bit of a calculation. So we're not going to get into the math and put everybody to sleep. What we're going to do is try and make a little chart and see how everything matches up. So all we need to know now is we've got to look at the back of our... 99% of all commercial speakers ever made have a plaque on the back, and it'll tell you what the nominal impedance is. And if somebody lost the plaque in a past, you know, cleanup or whatever they did, God, some people peel off those labels. Anyways, just look it up on Google. Just Google it. If you have any kind of a commercial speaker, you will find the specifications online. So, okay. So we now know what your nominal impedance is. We know we've got, let's say, two taps out. What do we do for connecting up? Well, obviously, if you've got a speaker with a nominal impedance of 4 ohms, you're going to take the 4-ohm tap, right? Everybody got that. Same for the 8-ohm, tap. Now, what if you've got a speaker with a nominal impedance that's not standard? What about 6 ohms, which is a really quite a common nominal impedance? Well, you're going to go with the 4 ohm out. Why in the heck are we doing that? Because it's easy for an output stage to drive from a low impedance into a higher impedance. It's not a perfect match, but it's going to be close enough that nothing is going to bad's going to happen. And the system is going to sound good. It's going to work well. You're going to get most of the power that your amp is capable of. Now, what if you did something like you took the 4-ohm tap and you drove a 2-ohm nominal speaker, a lower impedance? Well, you get 3 exclamation marks and a serious caution that this is a very unwise thing to do. Now, will it work? Yes, it will. Can it work at maximum volume? No, it will not. You will burn out something. Most likely, you're going to damage the output stage of your power amp. Now, if you've got a tube stage, you could damage the output tube. You could damage the output transformer. But if that's what you've got, if you've got a 4-3, might not be that bad. 4-2 is starting to get really bad. Can you listen to it at a normal listening level? Maybe. Now, how in the world are we going to figure out whether it's safe or not? Well, you're going to do a little test. And you're going to measure the temperature of your power supply, your power transformer. Now, if it's all tucked inside the amp, just find a good safe spot on the chassis, if it's an all metal chassis, that is close to the transformer where you can measure. Do not, and I repeat, do not go inside a live chassis to measure it. Now, on our kit monoblocks, the power transformer is right on top, where, in my opinion, it should be. It's out in the open air, it can ventilate naturally, and beside it is in behind the tubes, of course, because you want to see the tubes. If there's a lightning bolt, I want to see it. I'm totally into lightning bolts. And the output transformer is on the other side and behind the other tube. So you can easily, you can measure the temperature. So a good test would be to find a speaker that's loading the power stage properly, something like 4 ohm into 4 ohm, at your normal listening volume, and you can actually measure the temperature of the power transformer, not the output transformer, the power transformer, because it's the power supply that's going to have to work extra hard if you've got a load mismatch. And then you can bring in the speaker that you're wondering if it's going to be safe, and you can keep an eye on the temperature. You're going to have to do your test over the span of maybe an hour. We had a recent question about temperature on the GU50, and we ran an hour test and we ran a 4-hour test, and that gave us a sort of a good range of what the safe temperature should be. Now, obviously, if you're doing this test and things get hot really fast, you're going to shut down, right? You're doing this at your own risk. But it's one way to do this. Another way, which is at least as good, maybe even better, is to check to see if there's a volume change. So how are you going to do that? Well, let's start on the 4-ohm tap into, let's say, an unknown speaker system. We don't know what their impedance is. Maybe you built it and you're just not sure what it really, what it's operating at. So set your volume on your preamp, or if it's an integrated amp, set the volume on the integrated at a normal listening volume, and just sit back in your listening chair and have a listen at the one tap, shut down, right? If you're going to change any cables in the system, you always, always, always shut down. It's the safest thing to do. Switch over to the other tap. Don't touch the volume. Sit back and listen. Now, if the 8-ohm tap was louder than the 4-ohm tap, that's a sure indicator that the 8-ohm tap is actually a better choice, a better match. And if the 4-ohm tap was a little louder, that's a good indicator. Now, there's a possibility you're not going to hear any difference, in which case you're going to have to do, I would keep an eye on the temperature. That's a good indicator that the power supply is operating safely or that it's getting into trouble. In fact, anytime your tube gear or your solid state gear starts to get really hot, that's an opportunity to say, I think something might be wrong, and shut her down and take a look and see if you've miswired something. And you might have to bring your gear into a tech. Now, power amps like our GU50 and a lot of monoblocks and even some larger integrated amps, they do get hot. But do they get fry and egg hot? Not unless they're really large gear. So in the case of the GU50, I can put my hand on the power transformer after 4 hours. Now it's darn warm, but I can leave my hand there, and that lets me know that we don't have a loading problem and that the amp is working properly. Okay, now hopefully that helped you out a little bit. This is a topic that I've been thinking about how to approach carefully and safely so that you don't blow something up. And the general rule here is when you're doing your tests, do not do them for long. Just do them for a little bit of time, a few minutes, just long enough to check for volume levels. If you're doing a temperature test on your power supply, you're going to do it carefully, and you're going to do it at normal listening volumes. And the minute there's an indication of trouble, you're shutting down, right? Because you don't want to damage anything, especially when you've got a big mismatch. These are almost no-go zones, going from a 4 to a 2, or from an 8 tap down to a 4. Those are really no-nos. So, and you know, you might just miswire your system by accident, or you just didn't know that the impedance really needs to go from low into high, right? That's the safe direction, always. In fact, throughout an audio system, that's the safe direction. The earlier equipment has to have a lower impedance than the later stage. Okay, well, hopefully that helped out. It's bound to bring some comments, which are always fun. So what's been happening over at Melatonin Kits? Well, finally, and I say finally, we've got our lab benches mostly set up. We've got our tube inventory all in one place and mostly sorted. And I finally had time. The store actually slowed down for 2 whole days. I couldn't believe it. And Charles was away, so I was really glad. Because he's a big help when it comes to shipping orders. Anyways, I got back to the phono preamp. So let me show you something. Now, you might say, what in the heck? That's not a phono preamp. Well, actually it is. This is one channel. This happens to be the right channel. Let me get it up here for you. This is version 3.1. And I was listening to it yesterday, and it is dead quiet, and it sounds amazing. And best of all, the EQ is really close. Is it perfect? EQ for the RIAA. The EQ is never perfect. It doesn't matter what kind of quality phono preamp we're talking about. So what matters is, are you close to the EQ that's required? And does it sound good? And yes, I'm close, and yes, it sounds good. In fact, now, and you might say, what in the heck are all these resistors? Well, this is a prototype board. I took an existing board. This is actually a board that Charles designed for prototyping, so it can do a lot of interesting things. And we can put parts on the bottom as well. But it's not what the kits will eventually be. When the very first universal phono preamps are manufactured, they'll have a dedicated board in which all these components will have their own place. But for now, it's just easy for me to rework a board and get the circuit working properly, because I don't know if I'm going to have to add a component at a stage or subtract a component. So this way, I'm totally flexible. It is a little bit of a MacGyver. Yes, I'm dating myself by saying that, but it works perfectly fine. The dedicated board probably will be a little cleaner, but you know, you can see I've got everything has got space around it, and it's all neat. Anyways, the next job is to build the other channel exactly like this, and now the fun begins, because I have to check the voicing of the system. How in the world do you voice a phono preamp? Well, I'm glad you asked that. Let me go and grab some records. And throw a bunch of stuff on the floor. But, okay, let's back this out if we can. There we go. So, this is it's a compilation, and it's a compilation of Octave Records. And Octave Records, in case you don't know, is a small, high-quality label started by Paul at PS Audio. And they've been slowly but surely releasing great recordings. The pressings are really good. And this I've been saving for the real, I don't know, the birthing of the phono preamp, because this is going to be amazing. I love the sound of the cello, the Bach cello suites. You would recognize the opening bar of the suites right away. And no, I'm not going to hum it for you. anyways, this is how I always say, maybe you don't know, if you are a kit builder, at some point in the build, we start to get within sight of the end of the build. And I tell everybody, it's time to choose your first track. Because when that kit comes alive, that'll be the best moment to hear it critically. And there's two moments. There's when it first comes alive, and down the road, after you've got many hours of critical listening, now you can start to hear it again uniquely. It's just the way it is. When something is brand new to your ears, to your brain, to your system, you can hear it uniquely at the beginning, and then after you've gotten used to it, you can really, you know, pick it apart, be more critical. So this is probably what I'm going to start with when I have the phono preamp with two whole channels instead of just one channel. And it's going to be amazing. Anyways, I've been very impressed with Octave Records, and they have a sale on right now. So if you're catching this video in real time, jump on over to them. Okay, now I've been telling everybody that, let's clear the decks, that we're getting overstocked on Mother DL34s. And that it just continues. I'm not sure what goes on in the world of tubes, because let's zoom in for you. We'll go through this period in which we can't find a tube we're looking for 6 months. And then all of a sudden, the supply reappears and it starts flowing. It's just got to be chance, right? But look at these gorgeous tubes. This is an original Mullard EL34 XF2 series with an intact label. So this is a new old stock tube. How can you tell it's new old stock? Well, the label helps. It's not actually been tested. We still have a lot of these coming in. So, I like to do bulk testing. Testing one or two tubes is slow and painful. So I accumulate a whole bunch and then I'll run them through the power tube tester. But look at how full and beautiful that chrome dome is. That's a sure indicator that the vacuum inside is in good shape and that the tube hasn't been run hard for any length of time. And of course, the base looks good. The pins have a very tiny amount of wear on them because the tube's been in testers. You know, these tubes are now, how old are they now? They're roughly 60 years old. And they may have gone through a number of hands of people who buy and sell tubes. Somebody might have bought them and tested them and matched them for an amplifier. Who knows? Anyways, a little bit of wear on the pins is normal for a 60-year-old new old stock tube. And here's the same tube, but with an RCA label. Does that mean it's not the same tube? No, it's just a label. In fact, for a time, Mullard EL34 XF2s were probably the number one high-powered audio tube out there. They were showing up in guitar amps, they were showing up in audio amps, they were showing up in kit amps. Believe it or not, there were kit amp manufacturers that would actually sell you an amp with a quad of XF2s as part of the deal. Imagine that. Somebody had it was a good quality kit, but somebody would put some of the best sounding EL34s ever made into the kit deal because you could buy these affordably back in the 1960s. Not anymore, unfortunately. And that leads me to how to get an affordable XF2. Well, you wait until we're overstocked, and then you get a discount. We're going to run the discount till the end of the month. And the code is MULLARD15. That'll get you 15% off any of the quads in the store. It doesn't apply to any other tubes, to single Mullards. It doesn't apply to anything else in the store. That's the deal. And if you've always wanted to own a pair of some of the best sounding EL34s ever made, then this is your opportunity. We've got such a good inventory. You're going to get excellent testing tubes that are in great shape, whether they're used or whether they're new old stock. And of course, the regular discount supply, and there's a hidden discount that's fairly easy to figure out. Somebody got it just the other day, and it hurts, but it feels good because I know times are tough for a lot of people, and I love to see you guys grab the discounts. Don't forget we have flat rate shipping of $20 around the world, and if your order is $150, can't see it, but if the order is $150 and more after the discount, the shipping's on us, folks. Stay safe, everyone. This is Jim from Valves & More signing off. Cheers, everyone.